Good evening and a very warm welcome to all of you. I'm Vikram, I'm part of the Office of Outreach at CREA. And on behalf of everybody at the university, I extend a warm welcome to all of you to the 14th CREA Engage webinar series. At the School of Intro on Arts and Sciences, we offer a distinguished undergraduate curriculum in humanities, social sciences, literature, arts and the sciences. Taught by distinguished faculty from some of the world's finest academic institutions. Our academic program emphasizes our guiding principles of intermodal learning, a multi-directional approach to knowledge that encourages creativity, critical thinking, communication, contemplation, cross-disciplinary approaches, real-world implementation, and the ability to negotiate unanswered questions. Among the majors and minors that are offered at the School of Intro on Arts and Sciences, economics is not only the most popular social sciences major, but one of the most popular majors overall. In the last few years, we've seen a keen interest in economics as a major in Indian universities. One of the reasons this might be is due to the perception that the quality economics education prepares the student for a wide range of future career trajectories. Today, through this session, we discuss career possibilities with a focus on applications of behavioral economics in the working world. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Gaurav Ghosh, Associate Professor of Economics at CREA University, as a speaker of this lecture, Behavioral Economics in the Modern World. Gaurav is an economist with research, policy development, and private sector consulting experience. Along with his current position at CREA, he is a senior economist at Ernst & Young. Before joining EY, he spent 2 years as a postdoctoral researcher at RWTH Aachen University, Germany. He has a PhD from Penn State University, an MA from the Jawaharlal Nehru University, and a BA from St. Xavier's College, Mumbai. In recent engagements at EY, Gaurav has consulted with central government ministries on impact of taxes like the GST on investment incentives in the Indian economy. He has also set up a behavioral economics practice and consults widely on transfer pricing of financial transactions within MNCs. Like most of the faculty at CREA, Gaurav also has interwoven interests. Energy and environment has been a constant theme in Gaurav's non-consulting research. He has investigated diverse topics in areas using surveys, experiments, concepts of behavioral economics, and a variety of econometric methods. Over the years, Gaurav has spoken at conferences and venues around the world and published papers in reputed journals. He has also written extensively in financial papers on topics ranging from financial crisis through energy economics and negotiation strategies and Bitcoin. Very, very warm welcome, Gaurav, and over to you. We have over 190 listeners. So for all of you who are attending the session, so the first half an hour will be the talk by Professor Gaurav, post which we will open to questions. So whichever question that comes to your mind, you can put it in the Q&A box rather than the chat, so that we'll be able to take those after the session. Thank you. And Gaurav, over to you.
All right. Thanks, Vikram. Thanks for having me on this session. I'm very glad that, you know, I have the opportunity to talk to, you know, a lot of people who are interested in behavioral economics and about how it might be a good good subject for a subsequent career. So, as Vikram has, as you've already seen from the promotional materials, I am an economist. I have a lot of experience in various areas of economics, but behavioral research has been a throughput in, you know, what I've been doing. And so it gives me great pleasure today to talk about it, because I do see it as providing a large number of opportunities to people who are just starting their careers. So without further ado, I would like to get started talking about behavioral economics in the modern world. And to do that, I've prepared a couple of slides that, you know, I can share and that we can keep as a basis, as a background, as we go on with this discussion. As Vikram intimated earlier, I don't plan to speak for very long. I think it might be more interesting to have a bit of an interesting Q&A. So I shall keep it brief. I'll try to, you know, be done in about half an hour or so. And with that note, with that background, I suggest that we get started. All right. Right. So what I want to talk about today, and this is obviously of a lot of interest to a lot of you who I understand are, a large number of you who are on this call are students who are finishing out their 12th or their 11th, and then they're looking and they're thinking about their future career. So there are questions on what they can do with economics as a major and what they can do with perhaps a focus or a specialization in behavioral economics. Now, the interesting thing is that behavioral economics has been getting a lot of media attention, a lot of press over the last few years. And to some extent, it's because a few very well-known behavioral economists have won the Nobel Prize over the last 10 or 15 years. And beyond that, it's just a lot of people now realize that there are a lot of applications in a lot of different sectors. So before we started this call, I took a look at some of the questions that some of you have already submitted. And it seems to me that overall the sentiment is that there are applications of behavioral economics, perhaps in public policy and perhaps in finance. But here I want to assure you that the scope of behavioral economics is a lot larger than that. And we can take it and we can get into that as we proceed with this discussion. So, I guess the first question then is, what is behavioral economics? And here I don't want to get into too much detail. I mean, if you want to get into more detail, then I suggest you come and attend my lectures when I do present an entire semester's worth of information on behavioral economics. But broadly speaking, it is a bit helpful for us to understand how behavioral economics is a bit different from normal economics pedagogy and normal economics lecturing. And where it comes from is that it presents a deviation from classical economic methods in the assumptions that we make when we go ahead with research and thinking in behavioral economics. Now, all of you who've taken courses in economics already know that a lot of economics is based upon the idea of the rational man or the rational consumer. And what this basically means is that we assume that a consumer is always able to make the right, the consumer has a lot of information at his disposal. If he wants to make a decision, he has all the information related to that decision at his disposal. And he is able to then, analyze all this information in a split second very quickly and then come up with a rational decision and optimal decision. So, you can think of his brain like a computer, and he's optimizing on the basis of the information he's got. And then he's able to make the right decision. And, if we have a lot of people who are also thinking like this, who are rational consumers, we end up with a competitive market, and we end up with a large number of, economic conditions that we are used to when we see, a lot of the economic concepts that we see in high school, for example, are based upon this conception of, the economic decision maker as a rational man. But, it's a very strong assumption. So, and I know, and if we think about our own daily interactions, about how we go about buying things and making economic decisions, or, even talking to people and, watching our own behavior, right? I mean, we do realize that we're not really all that rational in the way we actually go about and do things. And so what this means then is that, classic economic ideas based around the idea of the rational man, they give us a good starting point, and they give us some good insight into the way macroeconomic decisions might be made, or the way certain microeconomic decisions might be made. They don't really quite get to the nub of individual decision making, because individual decision making, we will find, deviates quite a bit from this idea of the rational man. And so this is where behavioral economics comes in, because what it does is it relaxes some of these assumptions that we have about the rational man, and it brings in insights, from psychology, from decision science, from other fields. And then through application of these, these insights from other fields, we are able to get a more holistic, a fuller picture of economic decision making. And we are able to then understand economic decision making as it is made in the real world. And so therefore, behavioral economics gives us a better idea of how people actually go about, making their economic decisions. And when I say economic decisions, I'm talking about, it can be something as simple as, going to the store and buying a chocolate, or, maybe a larger purchase if you're looking to buy white goods, right? A television or a microwave or a fridge. Economic decisions are also about, larger lifestyle choices, right? I mean, if we're investing in insurance products, if we're investing in, you know, stocks in the stock market, these are all economic decisions that we're making. And to the extent that we understand the impetus behind these decisions, it helps us then make better decisions. Or, you know, if we're a firm who are interested in the way our customers make decisions, then understanding the behavior behind these decisions helps us understand our customers better and helps us make products that our customers might like or services that our customers might like, which would lead to, you know, greater benefit for the customers and would also lead to, you know, greater profits and greater visibility and greater performance of the firm in question. So when we're talking about relaxing behavioral assumptions, what am I talking about? An important assumption that does come about when we're talking about the rational man is that we assume that people are indifferent about whether they gain something from a transaction or whether they lose something for a transaction. So for example, you know, the classic example of this is, you know, supposing we take a bet, and from the bet we know that, you know, I could win 10 rupees or I could lose 10 rupees. And if I'm a rational person, then I will always take this bet because, you know, on average, I will neither win nor lose. And so I don't really mind if I lose a bit or if I gain a bit. But this is not actually the way, and, you know, there's a lot of behavioral economics research that supports this. This is not the way we actually think about money and how we think about gains and losses. And so, for example, from behavioral economics, we do have insights that losses actually matter a lot more to us than, you know, gains matter to us. So there are some studies that show, for example, that 10 rupees of losses is as painful or it causes as much distress as 30 rupees of gains would, you know, cause us joy. So, you know, there's this 3:1 ratio that has been empirically determined between gains and losses. And why is this important? I mean, you can think about this as being important because what it means is that we're a lot more cautious about making decisions than where we have the likelihood of even the smallest loss. And this, as you can imagine, can become quite interesting and be something that you can action upon when you're designing financial products. Or, you know, we saw a bunch of questions on behavioral finance, for example, and, you know, some of these insights, which are, you know, formalized in this, you know, sub-branch of behavioral economics called prospect theory, you know, these ideas come to the fore out there and then are used in these kind of fields. Another assumption that behavioral economics has is this idea of gratification, right? Traditionally, we tend to assume that, you know, people tend to be indifferent between future consumption and current consumption, right? But again, there's enough behavioral analysis that shows that we are much more primed psychologically to go for immediate gratification as compared to future gratification. And this in the end leads to behaviors where, you know, we might end up over-consuming today at the expense of having less consumption in the future. And this matters because, you know, this kind of insight has let us realize, for example, that people tend to underinvest in things like pensions, right? Because we think, ah, okay, you know, we're only going to see our pensions maybe 30 years from now or 40 years from now. So what does it matter? You know, we don't want, we end up saving too little for our future because we figure we'd rather spend that money today to go out for, you know, a nicer meal perhaps, or to buy the nicer shirt that we could have got. But this has very real consequences because what we are effectively doing is we're trading, you know, consumption today against much lower levels of consumption in the future. And so, and all of us are primed to do this, you know, I mean, you're primed to do this, I'm primed to do this, everyone is primed to do this, to, you know, prioritize the present over the far future. And what this means then is that if we leave people to their own devices, they'll tend to save too little for their future. And this can have consequences later on, right? And so therefore, if we understand this, and if we're thinking that, you know, as a society, we want to move to a situation where everyone is comfortable in their future, we would need to design products, pension products perhaps, or educate people about these kind of, you know, psychological fallacies that we have, where we, you know, prioritize the present over the future and think about, you know, how important it might be to actually save. And so there's a lot of, you know, work that goes on out here as well. And so, you know, this is another, you know, assumption on rational behavior that's relaxed. And then another one that, you know, comes across sometimes is something that's called mental accounting. And this is, for example, a lot of work in metal accounting was done by Richard Thaler, who won the Nobel Prize in 2018. You know, some of you might have come across some of his research and all that. And the basic insight out here is that, you know, when we are spending or when we are earning, or, we have our, income statements in our head, effectively, but it's not, one common income statement which has all costs and all expenditures and all incomes, but rather we have a bunch of separate accounts in our heads. So we might have an account in our head for, for long-term savings. We might have an account in our head for, running the household, for groceries and other items like that. We might have an account in our head for, how much money we're earning, if we're earning on a day-to-day basis. And we might have an account in our head that we keep aside only for entertainment. And what we do is that, when we start thinking about all this, implicitly we might say that we have, say, 1,000 rupees that we keep aside for entertainment in a month. And we have another, 1,000 or 15,000 rupees that we keep aside for, household expenditures. And we might, on the other hand, keep aside 25,000 rupees for savings that we'll keep for, that we'll put in our bank account or we might invest later on. And the way we think about these things is that effectively what we do is we bucket our expenditures into these categories and we spend until we hit the category limit. But what this might mean in the end is that our overall accounting and our overall expenditures are actually not very efficient. So Tala had a very interesting experiment that demonstrated this. And I'll talk about it to you a little bit because that might give you a bit of an idea of where I'm coming from, right? I mean, I think this discussion has been a bit abstract and, with a bit of an example, we can understand a bit more. So what he did was he looked at, he and his colleagues who worked on this research project together, they looked at the earnings of taxi drivers in New York over a period of time a few years ago. And the basic economic logic would be, and what they thought would be true, would be that, in times when demand for, taxi services are high, then you would expect greater levels of supply as well, right? Because demands are high, because you know that you can get a certain number of rides in a certain neighborhood, overall you expect that you'll be able to make a much larger amount of money in high demand periods. And so therefore supply will be higher in high demand periods and lower in low demand periods. But what they actually found when they were tracking, earnings of a large number of taxi drivers and, their movements over the course of, this period of time, what they found actually was that often, taxi drivers would end up working much harder on days which had low demand and working much less on days which had high demand, which, for an economically rational person doesn't make sense, right? Because if you're thinking rationally, then you would work higher on days where you get more rides. And so you'll earn that much more and you'll work less on days that you are not getting so many rides, and then overall it'll balance out and in aggregate you'll have more income. But actually what was happening was the opposite. And the reason for this, the reason that they ascribed to this was this idea of mental accounts. So what they found was effectively that very often taxi drivers had a target in their head where they said that, we will earn, say, $100 a day. That's my target. And once I earn that $100 a day, then that's it. I'm done for the day. And once once this insight was realized, then it all became clear, because clearly on days where you have higher demand, you'll get more rides more quickly. And so you hit that $100 limit that much faster. And so therefore you can knock off in, say, 5 hours, as compared to days with slow demand where you might need to work for 8 hours to earn that same $100. And this makes perfect sense also from, the taxi driver's perspective, when you understand that what he's actually doing is balancing off income versus leisure. So in this way, he's maximizing the amount of leisure that he also has, because, he's working less, he's earning the same amount of money, and now he has more time to go home and spend with his wife and his kids. So it's a perfectly rational decision from that perspective, but this was something that was not necessarily appreciated in classical economic theory. And behavioral economics in the end is a lot about all these kind of insights that, that have been developed and tested in the context of human decision-making behavior. And that's what makes it so interesting and so exciting. And what I would also say is that, beyond the fact that we're moving beyond the classical economic models, a lot of the work that happens is also about data collection. It's about analyzing the data, analyzing people's, understanding people's behavior through the data. So there is quite a strong empirical focus. So, you know, to the extent that people want to get involved in fields like this, they should be ready to also immerse themselves a little bit in statistics, a little bit in programming, because, you know, you need programming to run the statistical programs and so on. So with that in mind, I shall now talk a little bit about opportunities in behavioral economics itself. So there are a lot of opportunities that have been recognized in behavioral economics in the areas of retail and marketing, and the applications here are manifold. There are lots of applications out here. So for example, a lot of behavioral economics goes into understanding pricing strategy. You know, come again to, you know, our example of, you know, white goods producers, right? Suppose we're selling a television. You know, what is the price that a television should attract, I mean, should hold, such that, you know, the company is able to maximize its revenues from that. And, you know, this can be tricky, right? Because if the prices are too high, then, you know, fewer people will buy that television, especially when there are competitors in the market. And so therefore, you might not actually end up with the revenues that you expect. On the other hand, if you price your television too low, then your margins are low. So it's actually a less profitable business for you to be in. You might be selling more, but, you know, per unit, you're earning less. And overall, you might earn less than if you had, you know, the optimal pricing. And so so it's always an interesting question to understand what is the right price that you should set for a product. And behavioral economics has a lot of insights out here. It can for us, it can, for example, help us understand the value of the attributes of the product that we're looking at, right? I mean, if we're looking at a television, how much do people really value screen size? How important is it if the television has two USB ports or if it has three USB ports? How important is the brand of the television, right? I mean, if I know my brand value, then maybe I can charge a slightly higher, slightly premium price, right? And so these are the kind of questions that we can answer with behavioral methods. And then beyond that, we can also look at, you know, how do different pricing strategies work? You know, what are the impacts of rebates? Will they actually end up giving us more money in aggregate? What about bundled offers, right? I mean, what if offer might be when you might go to an electronic store, you might find that, you know, the television is being bundled with a sound box. Why is this happening? Is this actually making the television company money? Is it making the distributor, the company that owns the showroom, is it making them money, right? So a lot of these questions are, you know, what drive marketing and, you know, research and marketing and marketing decisions. And we find that these can be answered very well when we use behavioral insights to sustain our thinking in this area. And not related to this is the question of advertising impact, right? You know, especially today, right? We have so many different avenues for consumption of media and we're always on our screens. So it's becoming very, very difficult for companies actually capture the interests of potential consumers and then to sustain that interest. So what this means is that unless care is taken, ads are becoming less effective. But ads are a major cost that firms bear, right? So, you know, what can we use? Can we use behavioral methods? Can we use behavioral psychology to help make ads more effective, which will lead to greater impressions and which will lead to greater conversions and greater, you know, sales by the company that's producing the ads? And yes, I mean, there is a lot of work in behavioral economics that show that there are certain methods that can be used that will increase ad recall, that will increase the salience of the ad, will make it matter more to people who are actually interested in the purchasing decision, and so on. Then another area that's, you know, of relevance in sales and marketing is a question of sales negotiations, right? You need to know exactly what it is based on, you know, consumer prototypes. You know, what is it that consumers want? And once you know what consumers want, then you need to understand what is the best way to approach a consumer to try to convert an interaction into a sale. And then you need a measurement framework that helps you evaluate whether, you know, different types of sales strategies are effective and is strategy A more effective than strategy B? And if so, then what can be done? Can strategy B be improved, right? I mean, these kind of questions, these are empirical questions on which you can collect data. And you can analyze them in a behavioral framework, and it can lead to better overall sales negotiation practices. And then, I mean, I guess a lot of you who are interested in behavioral economics are already aware of the concept of the nudge, right? So what is a nudge? A nudge is, you know, it's a low impact intervention that, you know, kind of changes the frame, the information frame that a potential consumer might have and moves them towards a decision that is in your benefit, right? Or it might be in the, if, so you see a lot of this in public policy, for example, right? If we want to, you know, have a messaging framework to reduce, you know, tobacco consumption in the country, right? How do we do that? What kind of messages can we use to nudge people to move away from tobacco consumption, right? And here again, there are a lot of behavioral insights on what works and what doesn't work. And here we talk about information frames, right? I mean, should we provide the message by pictures? Should it be in words? Should it be by video? You know, what is effective? What is not effective? And, you know, so, yeah, so through utilizing behavioral economics insights, it's possible to do a lot of work in areas like retail and marketing. So, and we're already seeing that a lot, right? We see that a lot in other countries, and we're also seeing a lot more of that in India, where there's a greater understanding of the fact that there are behavioral interventions that can be had, and that can be leveraged, and can lead to, you know, better outcomes in these areas. There's a lot of behavioral economics now that goes into questions of management or HR or human resources. And here again, and the reason why this is important is because, you know, think again, what is it that behavioral economics gives you? It gives you a toolbox, a framework to understand how it is that people make economic decisions and to then measure interventions that you design about what these economic decisions might look like. And with all this put together, you know, I mean, there are a lot of applications in the area of people management, of, you know, HR. So you can imagine the use of, you know, behavioral methods to improve recruitment and to improve retention in firms. And this is something that's always very important, right? Because firms spend a lot of money in ensuring that they get the right people. And so they need to ensure that, you know, their recruitment strategies are effective. And once they have people on board, they need to ensure that they're able to keep their employees happy. And so because, you know, subsequent recruitment is harmful, right? You want to keep people. So then you need to understand what is it that motivates people? What is it, how do you make, you know, potential employees more loyal to the firm? When it comes to compensation structure, right? I mean, compensation structure, again, has a lot of different components. Our behavioral economics methods and experiments can help us understand these questions. And so therefore can help improve recruitment and retention. Another area where we see use is in the question of workplace services, right? You know, some of you are probably too young to have worked in or to have entered, you know, workplaces very often, right? But I mean, I can tell you that, you know, large firms especially, I mean, they offer a lot of services to their employees. You know, things like, you know, maybe food coupons, or maybe there's a canteen that's available, or, you know, maybe concessional healthcare, you know, things like that. And all of these things are, you know, provided to, you know, improve employee satisfaction. But at the same time, you know, these are things that, you know, cost a lot for the firm and it's rolled out for a large number of people. So, you know, there are very serious economic questions out here to decide what are the types of workplace services that should be offered and what are the features of the selected workplace services that should be offered. And here again, I mean, to answer this question, we need to understand consumer behavior or, you know, employee behavior. Here again, behavioral economics provides some solutions. And then beyond that, I mean, there are other applications also in the people space, right? One thing that we have been talking about a lot and is now also becoming quite important in this COVID era is this question of virtual offices, right? A lot of us are already working from home. You know, before COVID hit, there was a lot of talk about co-working spaces, right? There was talk about companies that were giving up office space and renting co-working space. But before making these decisions, we need to understand how does this affect productivity? You know, are these things that, you know, consumers or employees really want? And, you know, if there are, you know, if the cost benefit calculation by looking at these questions, you know, is positive, only then does it make sense to roll out these services. But before, you know, but to do this cost benefit calculation, behavioral economics can help because it can help us collect the data. Beyond that, you know, we all know that, you know, CSR, corporate social responsibility, is an important thing nowadays, right? And here again, behavioral economics can help. Right? Water and energy conservation, right? This is again related to the public policy question, right? I brought up earlier. If we want to reduce, you know, smoking, what kind of messaging works? if we want to make people more punctual, right? I mean, what kind of messaging works? How can we, you know, influence people to use less energy, to use less water? A lot of interesting things that behavioral economics can say out here. Beyond that, obviously, I mean, there is behavioral economics in the public policy space. And this is something that, you know, a lot of you are probably most familiar with. And here again, you know, there are a large number of questions that are asked and answered with using behavioral economics. So a lot of work, for example, goes into tax compliance, right? No one likes paying taxes. So, you know, a lot of governments have set up, you know, behavioral nudge units around the world. And a lot of what they focus on is this question, right? How is, what is it that, you know, actually incentivize people to pay taxes, right? What are nudges? What are, you know, communication frameworks? What are nudges that can be used to increase tax compliance across the entire country? And, you know, there are a lot of different nudges that have been explored, some more effective, some less effective. You know, the question then also becomes, you know, are nudges more effective than penalty frameworks? Should we look at reward frameworks, perhaps, you know, where we reward people who do pay their taxes on time regularly over a long period of time? So these are questions that we can, you know, look at through a behavioral economics lens. Beyond that, there's a lot of work that goes into public health issues. So, you know, one public health issue that all of us around the world face today is the question of, you know, the use of a lot of people. I mean, there's a lot of science now that shows that, you know, wearing face masks is helpful in halting or in slowing the spread of COVID-19. But, you know, we do see it everywhere on the roads that, you know, sometimes people don't wear the face mask, or if they don't wear the, or if they do wear the face mask, they might not be, you know, wearing it correctly. So, you know, what can we do about this? You know, how can we voluntarily get people to wear their face masks more effectively? You know, what kind of messaging frameworks can be used? Or what kind of interventions can we design? And if we are, you know, testing, I mean, if we have a few interventions in mind, then it's helpful to be able to test these interventions, right, one against the other. And if we can do that, then we can come up with better strategies to answer these kind of public health questions. Behavioral economics can be used in, you know, the questions of public education as well, right? I mean, this is, there's a lot of work that goes into showing that, you know, public education in India, for example, is less effective than it can be. And one of the reasons for that is teacher attendance might not be very high. So, you know, what can be done about this, right? We need to understand what is going on out here. What are the drivers of decisions that lead to poor teacher attendance? And what can be done to improve this, right? And yeah, so that's what, I mean, the field is vast, right, in public policy. In effect, we should just think that anything, any question that has a public policy impact, anything that does affect a large population, there are behavioral interventions that can be used to understand how these interventions are going to be appreciated by consumers, by taxpayers, or, you know, what is it can be that can be done such that, you know, consumers or taxpayers take decisions that are in their own interest, right? Like the public health interventions I was talking about. And the reason why this is becoming important is because, you know, as I already, you know, mentioned, you know, at the start of this lecture, we are not in the end very rational consumers, and we often find ourselves making decisions that might provide instant gratification but are not beneficial in the long run. And so, you know, we need to cut that, you know, if we're looking to cut that, you know, vicious cycle, then perhaps there are behavioral interventions that can help. But then to understand which is the most effective behavioral intervention, there's a lot of work that can be done using behavioral economics methods to come to those kinds of answers. So I've been talking for a while, and so I won't talk too much more, but I would like to talk a little bit more about the fact that, you know, there's a lot of application of economics overall, and, you know, behavioral economics coming within the subset of economics, within the overall framework of economics as a whole, in the online world, right? And, you know, by online world, what do I mean? I'm talking about our largest companies, right? Your Googles, your Facebooks, your Amazons, you know, a lot of these large firms which have a lot of interaction with a lot of consumers, right? Often, you know, billions of them. And so their prime need, obviously, is to understand their consumers. And there's a greater understanding now over the last few years that economists can actually help a lot with this. So we are seeing a lot of, I mean, and this is quite a new trend now, it's not very old, but we are seeing that there is a lot of, you know, there are a lot of economists who are now getting hired by a lot of tech firms. So, you know, for example, and this quite surprised me as well, it turns out that in the last 2 or 3 years, Amazon has become the largest hire of PhD economists in the world. But, you know, a single company that's hiring, you know, more than 200, 300, you know, PhD economists every year. So if you think about that, I mean, these are tremendous opportunities that are opening up at the link, at the intersection between economics and computer science. And the reasons for these are manifold. And I put some of these reasons out here. One of the reasons, obviously, is that, you know, as you know, we all know about, you know, AI, artificial intelligence, and ML, machine learning, and, you know, data science and all that, right? A lot of the hottest jobs that we see today seem to be in these areas. But now a lot of firms are realizing that, you know, just having mastery in these areas is not sufficient. And the reason for that is that in the end, AI and ML are very good for prediction. So, you know, for example, you know, if you're on Amazon, for example, you know, you'll be getting a stream of recommendations on the basis of, you know, products that you've already looked at. And these are powered by very powerful, you know, AI, ML engines that are going on in the background. And they very often do a very good job in predicting, you know, the kind of things that you might want to buy on the basis of your previous history. But the problem that people are now realizing with these kind of methodologies is that these are black boxes. People don't understand exactly how these algorithms actually work in practice. And this is now leading to real world problems, algorithmic biases. So, you know, there is research that now shows, for example, that, you know, some of these algorithms will lead to, you know, adverse outcomes for minority groups, or, you know, for example, in the US, we do find that, you know, African-American and Hispanic populations seem to be targeted adversely by AI and ML algorithms when it comes to pricing their housing loans and things like that. And these are not things that anyone expected, right? But, you know, these are things that are happening. These are cause for serious concern. And what people are finding now is that it's very difficult to use these, to understand why these methods are driving all this. But one way to do this, to understand the why, is to bring in economics. And here I'm talking about, I mean, so here now I've moved a bit beyond, you know, just behavioral economics, but economic methods in general and econometrics, which is, you know, about applying economic principles to very large data sets. So there's a lot of work that started happening in this area, and this trend is going to increase over time. You also use, you know, economists are also useful for, you know, firms like these when it comes to questions of advertising optimization, right? Advertising in the end, you know, a lot of it has moved online, as some of you might know. You know, if you go to websites, you'll see a lot of ads and banners on the side. If you're on YouTube, you know, every few minutes, you know, your video will stop and an ad will pop up. And there's a lot of science, and again, you know, AI and ML engines that go behind selecting the ads that are displayed to you. But the problem out here now is that, you know, the companies that are paying for these ads, they need to be convinced that a purchase that might be happening, you know, 3 days later can be attributed to that ad that they saw on YouTube. And to identify this, we basically need to make a causal inference. Right? We need to say that this ad X contributed 30% to the eventual purchase that was made 3 days later. And to do this, economic methods and econometric methods have now been recognized as, you know, things that can be used. And then beyond that, obviously, you know, as I've already spoken earlier, there are behavioral economics methods that improve user engagement and influence behavior. And, you know, these can be used in the real world, as I was talking about earlier, but obviously they can also be used online. So there's work that goes on out here. And the reason why economists become useful in these firms is because they've been trained to focus on causal inference. And, you know, you all might have come across, you know, a very common statement, right, which says that, you know, correlation does not equal causation, right? And meaning that, you know, if X and Y move together, then that doesn't mean that X causes Y or vice versa. But this is actually not a complete statement, because there are a lot of econometric methods, and there's a whole foundation of economic theory that kind of looks at exactly this question to establish causality, to say with certainty, yes, we can say that X and Y may be correlated, but X is also causing Y. And so if you do, you know, sufficient economic training, you'll be able to actually design these kind of experiments and these kind of treatments yourselves and do this kind of causal inference. And this is what a lot of these tech firms are now looking for, to help understand consumer behavior and to help optimize the advertisements. And a lot of different other similar questions they look at working with these large data sets. Beyond that, I don't know if you read the news today, but you would have found out that the Nobel Prize for Economics was announced today, or maybe it was last night, and it was awarded to two US economists. And both of them have made their careers in designing auctions. And they've done a lot of work on, you know, spectrum allocation. And auctions are actually, again, a very large part of how a lot of our tech firms make money, right? So Google, for example, makes a lot of money through advertisements. And how they allocate their advertisements is through auctions and through two-sided markets. Uber also uses two-sided markets. Two-sided markets are, again, a variation on, you know, auction frameworks. So, you know, you can imagine that, you know, we have these very powerful economic ideas that are now being used in real time by a lot of tech firms. And so there's quite a bit of work that goes into understanding these kind of things. And, you know, and you need to be an economist to do that. I will impose a caveat, though. I mean, a lot of the things that I'm talking about out here, these are not things that, at least today, at the stage of the science today, these are not things that you can get to with an undergrad in economics. You would need to do a master's, possibly a PhD. And the reason for that is that the level of information, the level of research that happens in these areas is very high. And just to get an understanding of, you know, economic theory on the one hand and AI methods on the other and so on, and, you know, econometrics, you know, it just takes a lot of time. But there are opportunities here, and they're tremendously exciting opportunities. So, yeah, so I mean, I think I'll end here, you know, with my, you know, structured talk about the kind of jobs that you might be able to find. And, you know, I hope you found it interesting. I hope you found something to think about. You know, overall, you know, what you take away is that, you know, economics is an exciting subject. Behavioral economics is an exciting subject. There are, you know, jobs that are on offer that look for specific economic skill sets. And yeah, so, you know, hopefully, you know, I don't say that this should convince you to do economics, but I hope it gives you a good picture of, you know, where the field is going and what kind of opportunities you can get. So, you know, thank you for listening to me. And now I'll push it back to Vikram.
Thank you, Gaurav. I hope everybody can hear me, and I think there was some problem with the mic, but thank you so much for that wonderful conversation and explaining so beautifully about behavioral economics and also its applications and careers that people can have in, you know, in people management or retail and marketing or policy or, you know, even online, the online industry. So moving now to questions, I think we have a ton of questions that we've received in the chat. But before this, we'll also take some questions that we keep receiving from students over and over again, right? And I think this will help students who are attending the session to understand who should choose economics. So one of the questions is, you know, students, though I know that students from the sciences, humanities, commerce, anybody can apply and pursue economics as a major. But one of the most common confusions they have is whether to choose a business major or an economics major. And you know, what are the differences, and who should choose economics versus who should choose business? And adding to this question, is there a benefit or an advantage that the science students get when they join economics versus the commerce or humanities students?
Right. Okay. So that was actually a series of questions put together, and I might not remember all of them. So I'll try to parse them and, you know, give you a few words on each. So I guess one of the questions was this question of, you know, if you're going for a major, is it more beneficial to have a science background or to have a humanities and or commerce. A commerce background, right? So what I will say is it kind of depends on what you want to do with economics. In effect, what you will find is that a lot of people who end up doing econ majors, who do a bachelor's in economics, are not going to end up becoming economists per se, right? They might, they will eventually end up doing an MBA and then, you know, go down the MBA career path. So if that is the case, then I don't really see any specific benefit to what your underlying major really was, because I mean, when you have a science background, then presumably your quantitative skills are quite strong, right? And that will definitely help you in some of your economics classes during the undergrad itself, right? I mean, your econometrics classes, your statistics classes, these might be easier for you to get into because you're already used to thinking about numbers. But then if after that you're going to end up doing an MBA, because you know that's the career path you see as most promising for you, then once you're, I mean, in the MBA itself, there are a lot of different streams that you can be following. And some of them might be more suited to a more quant-oriented, you know, thinker. But a lot of them are not, right? A lot of them are not so quant-driven. And then you will also find that in the end, in the workplace, you know, a lot of MBAs will end up using tools like Excel a lot. And they'll be doing a lot of, you know, ideation, coming up with, you know, reports and coming up with PowerPoint presentations and things like that. And here, what's important is to have a very structured way of going about thinking, which, you know, an education should impart to you. But you can get this kind of education on structured thinking, whether you have a science background or whether you have an arts background or whether you have a commerce background. I think to do for that, a lot of it depends on the quality of the university that you go to, and before that, to the school you go to, and the teachers you had, if they're able to help you think and analyze and break down problems. So this is, you know, if we're looking at, you know, the MBA track in the future. But now let's look at the question of, you know, if you want to focus on, you know, being an economist. Is that, you know, doing a master's in economics afterwards, and then maybe potentially doing a PhD in economics. So now here again, right, I mean, if we think back to what I was talking about, I will say that, you know, if you're doing higher studies in economics, a certain level of quantitative knowledge is becoming increasingly important. And I will say that if you don't have a strong quant background, it will hurt you if, for example, you would not be able to consider the kind of tech careers I was talking about, right? Because for careers like that, it's very expected that you will also have a some sort of programming background along with your, you know, very strong economic skill set. And you will be familiar with working with large data sets, which means that you will be familiar with econometrics and statistical concepts and, you know, and so on. At the same time, though, I mean, there are other, you know, streams of economic research that are not so quant oriented, right? It depends on you again. So there's a lot of spillover, for example, nowadays between economics and the other social sciences. So, I mean, economists are working with sociologists, they're working with psychologists. You know, a lot of the behavioral work I was talking about, the level of, you know, math sophistication you need, it depends on the kind of work you want to do. So to summarize, I will say that I do feel that, you know, a quant background is definitely beneficial, but it's not necessary. What you should also keep in mind, though, is that, you know, in a good economics program, like the one that we offer, a lot of the intent is to impart a sufficient level of quantitative training so that all our economics graduates will have the bare minimum that they need. Well, forget that, much more than the bare minimum that they need, that they can focus on, you know, much more quant questions in the future if they want to. And even if they don't, I mean, that the base skill set is there. So I hope that answers.
It does. Thank you, Gaurav. Actually, the first part of the question that I think got missed was, I think this whole dilemma, so, you know, when in India, we are very streamlined education, right? Especially when you come from an Indian board, whether it's the CBSE or ISE or state board schools, where there are tracks, science, commerce, humanities, right? So science students are typically posed towards going into medicine or architecture or engineering, whereas there's a stream of commerce students who are typically only looking at BCom or a BBA, and more business and management programs.
Yeah.
So economics is getting popular now. So like, how should students choose between doing a business degree and an economics degree? Like, who should choose what? And what are sort of some of the bird's eye view differences between both the majors?
So I guess your question is basically, should it be the BBA or should it be the a BA in economics?
Yes.
Right. So now here my perspective on this is, what is the purpose of the BBA or the BA, right? I mean, if I'm going to be doing an MBA later on, because that's what, that's what I think is best for my career, then isn't it true that doing a BBA will result in a lot of overlap between what I learned in my BBA course and what I will later learn in my MBA course? And now if there is an overlap, what this means is that, maybe the MBA will be a bit easier, but I will learn a lot less, right? Because I mean, the curriculum that I've been exposed to will be that much narrower. Whereas if I do a bachelor's in economics, I mean, I will be covering a lot more topics, and a lot of them will be useful for the MBA program itself. But a lot of them will kind of become my desideratum of information, which will become useful when I'm having, I mean, in my working life. I mean, it's in the end, we are, the way we go about our working life, or the way we go about our lives overall, is based upon our experiences. And I do believe that having a wider range is beneficial in the long run than having a narrower range. And so to that extent, I would say that an econ and then MBA track might be a stronger combination than a BBA and an MBA track.
Good. Thank you. And to adding, I think, Gaurav, you did already mention about the math requirement and this whole confusion. So I think and a lot of universities across the world would require students to do math in 11th and 12th if they want to apply for economics. Whereas at CREA, we know that that's not the prerequisite, and students without math background can also apply to economics. But you also said that economics is by a field becoming more and more quant savvy, and to a certain extent, quant will be required. So how do we deal with that? Like, when a student who's not done math comes into an economics major at CREA, what should they expect? What level of math should they expect in an economics major?
In an economics undergrad degree, BA.
Yes.
So we have foundational courses in mathematics, and we have foundational courses in statistics. And these are courses that everyone does in CREA when they join the undergrad program, irrespective of whether they, decide to major in economics or in, psychology or in physics, or no matter what, because we truly do believe that a certain level of quantitative knowledge is essential in today's workplace. And, this is true, not just in economics, but even in other fields, right? The point is that there's so much more data right now in all fields, and people are realizing that analyzing this data can reveal insights. And so the reason why quant training becomes important is that it's not necessarily that you will be doing a lot of quantitative work going forward in your career, but if you have a certain level of quantitative training, you will be comfortable looking at the results that other people give you, right? I mean, you won't be lost. If someone's talking about hypotheses and F-tests and T-tests and certain regression terms and all that, you will understand what they're talking about, and that'll make you that much more effective in your workplace. So I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, it does. In
the econ program itself, in the econ program itself, there will be more specialization. Yeah, sorry. I mean, there'll be more quant courses according to the interests of the students.
Okay. One of the other questions that we always receive, you know, I mean, obviously students come to a liberal university because they have the power of choice and you know, being able to combine different interests. So I think there is, I can see so many questions in the chat box where students are asking about psychology along with economics, and is psychology required for somebody who's doing behavioral economics? But to actually, you know, increase the scope of this question, what are some of the minor combinations that are popularly available, and you know, what are some of the joint majors that students will be able to do at CREA along with economics?
Right. Okay. So psychology and economics to do behavioral economics. Yeah, I mean, that's a very logical question. So me personally, I did not have any psychological training when as I progressed along my economics career and I started focusing on areas of behavioral economics. What I do find is that, I mean, it is helpful. So, you know, when you will see a lot of literature on, you know, where psychologists and economists, for example, work together. And a lot of insights in behavioral economics are naturally drawn from psychology. But we should understand that behavioral economics is an intersection of psychology and economics in some sense, but not a very large intersection. There are very large parts of psychology that are not really relevant to behavioral economics, at least as the field is today. And similarly, there are very large parts of economics that are not relevant to behavioral economics as it is today. So if you are thinking of doing a double major of the two subjects, then it is interesting. I mean, it would make sense to kind of check to ensure that the kind of coursework that you're putting together is something that falls within the intersection of psychology and economics in the context of behavioral economics. And you don't end up doing a lot of stuff that is way outside the field, because that might be interesting, but that's moving you away from your core interest in behavioral econ. Beyond that, other subjects that go well with econ, I will say that, yeah, you know, statistics goes very well with economics. Math can go pretty well with econ. You might be surprised to hear that a lot of other, you know, arts fields actually are now going pretty well with economics. I mean, these are still pretty specialized areas, but, you know, economic history, for example, is a very interesting field. It's not something that, you know, you might be hired. I mean, like, corporate firms might not be looking for economic historians, but they do a lot of very interesting work. And so, you know, if you're interested in questions like, you know, the railways that were built in the British Raj, right? Did they actually help India or did they hurt India? Were they used as extractive mechanisms to take out surplus from the country? Or did they lead to, you know, merging of markets and geographically displaced regions and therefore working towards some sort of common market and the benefits that those entail? If these are the kinds of questions that interest you, you know, history and economics can go pretty well together. Similarly, there's a lot of work right now in GIS, geographical information systems is another very hot area. This is about, you know, map making, you know, Google Maps, collecting data at geographical specifications, understanding how to work with the geographical data, marrying it to economic data. So this is again something that's quite interesting, and there's a lot of work that goes on out here, and there are, you know, a lot of commercial applications out here as well. So I mean, I think that there is flexibility with respect to mixing and matching majors. And, you know, we're always happy to talk about these things because, again, right, I mean, what should be kept in mind is that some of these, you know, merged fields might be smaller than others, but, I mean, that does not mean that they're not interesting. And that does not mean that they should not be considered, perhaps.
So much for that. Another question that I think is very relevant is, you know, why businesses, you know, business is, of course, is more popularly known as a major amongst the recruiters in India. Economics is obviously gaining popularity. how ready is the industry, to accept econ major students? And somebody who's in the corporate now, you're a senior economist with ENY. How do you think is India ready for economics majors students?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, that's a very topical question, right? Because a lot of our students, a lot of the people on this talk are thinking, 3 or 4 years ahead and looking at when they'll be on the markets themselves. I think you're right. I mean, I think in the end, I mean, econ is seen as a bit more of an abstract field, and business is seen as more of a practical field, and with greater immediate application in jobs. So maybe, there are firms that would prefer people who do have a specific business major versus an economics major. I mean, I can't say much more than that, because I mean, in the end, I've been away out of the job market, at least, the junior level job market for a very long time now. So yeah, I mean, I can't really say much. I don't know if Prithvi, for example, might have something more to say on that. But understand that it's possible that business majors might have more immediate market relevance than econ majors. I will, however, add to this, which is to say that another trend that we do see today is that people don't really stop at a bachelor's degree. Right? A lot of people are interested in perhaps doing a bachelor's, maybe working for a couple of years, and then doing an MBA. And if that is the path that's of interest, then it's possible that your econ degree might land you a more interesting job or a more slightly more unusual job, which might help you in your career over the longer term, just because you have slightly different experiences. And this is also something that, that recruiters do look for, right? I mean, they do look for people who do have slightly different interests, who have slightly different work experiences, slightly different training. So there's that to consider as well.
Sure.
And Prithvi has indicated, he said that, the econ and business study major combination is anyway available at TRIA. So, if you are confused about this, just go for both, and we'd be happy to have you with that. So,
absolutely, I think at TRIA you can do a econ major and a business major, so that's certainly available. I think the final question that is from the previous hybrid questions was, I think, and also one of the questions that we are getting in the chat, Gaurav, is why TRIA? I mean, there are traditional universities like or colleges like the St. Stephen's or Madras School of Economics who've been teaching economics for the longest time. So why TRIA and also this model of interwoven learning, how does that help an economist or an economics graduate from TRIA?
Yes. Well, I mean, I guess this kind of comes down to what you're looking for in a program, right? I mean, the idea behind TRIA is this question of interwoven learning, which in turn leads to a question of all-roundedness, right? I mean, our idea is that you should not be defined but very narrowly by the major that you're taking, but you should have sufficient exposure to other fields, other ways of thinking, other philosophies, so that, overall you become a more, you're able to think maybe outside the box, to use the cliche. You're able to think beyond the perspective of just your field, but you can also think along the perspective of, adjacent fields or, even very different fields. Because what we do find is that, if you only do econ, you'll only think as an economist does. Or if you do, physics, you'll only think as a physicist does. And this colors your worldview and you end up, thinking along very certain lines. And, often this is sufficient. But if you can kind of switch perspectives, if you have multiple perspectives, you might find that you're able to actually analyze abstract problems better. And you're able to come up with ideas better. And again, I mean, I think that in the long run, this kind of more Catholic, more broad-based kind of education holds you in good stead, because you're able to, perhaps speak a bit better, present a bit better, come up with ideas that other people might not be coming up with. And this is something that we do, hope to inculcate in our students at TRIA. And I do believe that our curriculum is geared towards that. And so to answer your, and So that's one aspect of it. Another aspect, obviously, is the fact that, you know, things like, you know, classroom sizes are much smaller. So, you know, there's a much greater level of interaction among students, amongst themselves. There is a much more interaction with faculty. And this is something that you will not see, for example, in, you know, universities that might have much larger classroom sizes. And I do think that, you know, these things do matter. They help you understand your field a lot better. They help you understand your matter a lot better.
Thank you. So now we have a ton of questions, so we'll sort of do like a rapid fire and try to answer as many of them. So the question from Palak Rajput, she says, good evening, sir. I'm a grade 9 student of ISA. Three questions. What challenges do you think future college students about 10 years from now, or maybe after COVID, will face after graduating?
So let me get the question. What sort of challenges do you think college students will face 10 years from now?
Or sort of like a post-COVID era.
Post-COVID era, right. That's a good question, right? I mean, on so many levels. I guess the first part is, are we ever going to be in a post-COVID era, right? I mean, or is this something that we are going to have to live with for quite a while? And I mean, the point is that, yes, I mean, there is so much uncertainty today, right? And in everyone's lives. And I can imagine, especially in the lives of, you know, a lot of our audience today who are just finishing their school and looking to get into college and thinking about their future 3 or 4 years from now. I think my answer can only be a bit of crystal ball gazing based on, you know, my analysis of the news and, you know, extrapolation of trends. But I do think that, you know, this kind of work from home environment is going to stay for a while. Maybe not in this absolute form, but I do think that even as we do open up, a lot of firms are finding, for example, that perhaps they don't need to maintain such large offices. They don't need to have 10,000 people in a vast, you know, building in an office park on the outskirts of a city. And to the extent that they don't, to the extent that they don't require this, if they find that productivity is actually not being affected by this kind of remote working, we're going to see a lot less of, you know, actual requirements of, you know, 9 to 5, going to the office 5 days a week or 6 days a week, because in the end, this will also help firms cut down a lot on their costs, the kind of services they need to, you know, provide to their campuses, or, you know, the size of the campuses themselves, rental costs, so on and so forth. So I think we should get, you know, a bit used to the fact that we might have to, you know, work like this even moving forward. That's one point. Another point is that, and we are seeing this trend towards so many things now happening online, right? And I can't imagine a scenario where this does not increase in the future. We already do buy a lot of things online, you know, a lot of interactions have moved online. And even post-COVID, I mean, some of this might reduce, but it won't go back to the level it was maybe 5 or 10 years ago. And related to that, I mean, a lot of skills that we need to develop need to be geared towards success in this online space. And to some degree, it's having greater skills with, you know, working with data. To some degree, it's being able to manage your online avatars better, right? I mean, all of us are now on Facebook, a lot of us are now on Instagram. A lot of us, especially, you know, who started working have LinkedIn profiles and all that. So, you know, it becomes important to understand what is it in the, you know, how do we optimize these so that they help us with, finding interesting jobs or meeting interesting people or so on. And then the jobs themselves, right? I mean, I think what's very clear is that COVID has been a massive economic shock, right? I mean, the numbers coming out indicate that Indian GDP shrank by almost 25% over the last quarter. And that is massive. I mean, these are numbers that I don't even think was seen in most countries in the Great Depression, for example. So, I mean, we're in unprecedented times as far as economic stress goes. So what this means is that we can expect a fairly soft job market for a while. And I mean, my hope is that, you know, we have what they call a V-shaped recovery, meaning that, you know, we've hit the bottom and then we're going to bounce back up and things are going to be back to normal as far as, you know, jobs and salaries and expectations go in 6 months. I really hope that. Will it happen? I'm not so sure, because I mean, COVID is still progressing, and you know, the kind of massive job losses that we've seen, across the economy, it's very difficult to unwind these things very rapidly, because you know, that's just the way these systems work. So I mean, I do think that, yeah, it's going to be a bit tough for the next you know, in the short term, I do hope that things will improve moving forward. And definitely in 10 years from now, I hope we'll be in a much better place than we are today, not, you know, sitting behind our screens.
Absolutely. Hoping for the best. The next question is from Nalini Astana. She says, behavioral economics is generally used to understand the markets and producers' target audience. Why would somebody prefer consulting a behavioral economist rather than a medical behaviorist to understand psychology of consumers?
Okay, so who is it who's going to be hiring the behavioral economist or the medical behaviorist? I didn't quite get the question, sorry.
I think the question is, should I repeat the question for you? Or
yes, please. Repeat the question.
So she says, behavioral economics is generally used to understand the markets and producers' target audience. Why would somebody prefer consulting a behavioral economist rather than a medical behaviorist to understand psychology of consumers?
I will say that in the end, all this is contextual. To understand human behavior in an economic context, in a market context. Now, to understand economic behavior in an economic context, you need to understand how markets work. You need to understand how people respond to incentives. And you also need to understand the psychology of decision making. So to answer a lot of these questions, you do need an economic training, because without that, you will not be able to, you know, kind of talk about the market aspect of it, or, you know, why people make the economic decisions that they do. A medical behavioralist, I'm not really sure what that is, but I assume it's something like a psychiatrist perhaps. But someone with this kind of training maybe would be focused more towards looking at things from a diagnostic or from a medical perspective, and not necessarily from the perspective of a perspective that would be of interest to marketing companies or companies that spend a lot of ad money, right? So it is, I mean, these are all important things to look at. But if the perspective is, you know, where do I spend my marketing dollars, it makes more sense to go to a behavioral economist than someone with a medical training.
I think a question similar to that is that MBA has not mentioned their name, it's anonymous. It says, nudges are no doubt a powerful tool to alter the behavior of consumers into making the right choice. But what happens when immense power of nudging falls into the wrong hands? When it is used to fill pockets of MNCs and interest-seeking companies in general, who decides what is the right choice for consumers? So I think it's also a big question with the fourth industrial revolution and the inequality.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, these are very valid questions, right? I mean, in the end, I mean, I think we should think about these things as tools, right? I mean, the design of nudges, the implementation of experiments to help us understand these nudges, how consumers behave. These are tools that assist us in our decision-making, the decisions themselves. So in that sense, I mean, these tools, we should think of them as being agnostic from the perspective of morality. The tools are not designed to be purely good or purely evil. They kind of help us get where we want to go, right? And it's the same with any tool, for example, right? I mean, if we think of language as a tool, you can use language to say nice things about someone. You can use language to hurt someone's feelings tremendously. You can use language to heal society. You can use language to harm society. But this does not mean that language is good or bad. Language is the tool that you're using, and how you use it then is up to the person who's doing it. So I would say that it's the same with a lot of these kind of methods as well. I mean, they're not inherently good methods or they're bad methods, but their implementation is something that, yes, it does need to be monitored. And so then I think the question is, what can you do about it, right? I mean, what you can do is you can at least ensure that in your own perspective, in your own sphere of decision making, these tools are used the way that they should be used. But beyond that, yes, what can we do, right?
Sure. Gaurav, with your permission, can we extend by another 5 minutes? Can we extend this by 5 minutes?
Sure.
Another question is, often behavioral economics is viewed as a field of study that somewhat arrogantly takes upon itself the duty to nudge people towards the right choices. but the supposed irrationalities in human behavior that have evolved because they are beneficial to humans. So should there also be a space that acknowledges the positive impact that heuristics can have?
Well, I mean, heuristics are just shortcuts for decision making. And, you know, if you're talking about, heuristics in the end, now we need to get a bit into, you know, system one and system two thinking and all that. And yes, there are obviously advantages to using heuristics for your decision making from a computational perspective, right? We don't want to engage in very deep thinking for very minor decisions all the time because, you know, we just don't have the mental capacity for that. So that's just the way we are, right? That's just the way we've evolved. But that has, but that's just the way things are. I don't really see it as having much relevance to, you know, the applications of behavioral economics or not. Behavioral economics, it helps us understand what these heuristics are, these decision-making heuristics are. And once we understand it, then yes, we can use these kind of heuristic frameworks to help to nudge people towards decisions that we think are beneficial or are not beneficial. But I don't see any fundamental conflict between having a heuristic, set of heuristics to make decisions and using behavioral economics to understand how these design nudges.
Thank you. To what extent is nudge theory used in public policy in India? And there's a part B to this question, which says, what is the ideal mix of traditional policy versus nudge policy in handling market failures or promoting government intervention?
Okay, so first of all, I would say that nudge theory has a very small role to play in the design of, in addressing market failures when compared to your traditional instruments that are, you know, designed and policy, you know, other policy discussions and all that. The idea of nudges being used for public policy in the end is a fairly new trend. And this is something that has been, you know, that is being explored in India. So, you know, for example, I do know that, you know, and you would have perhaps seen as well that, you know, Niti Aayog is interested in the idea of using nudges in the public policy context. And, you know, there's been discussion by the CBDT on, you know, how can we use nudges to improve tax compliance, for example, and there's been some work in these areas. I think we should keep in mind that what is it that a nudge can do and what is it that a nudge cannot do? And in the end, a nudge has a very limited level of, a limited set of tools where it can be implemented. Public policy is much, much larger than that. So there are much larger questions of public policy where, you know, using nudges does not really matter or does not really apply itself. So it's a tool, I think, it's an excellent tool for communication. It's an excellent tool to hopefully get people to modify their behaviors in socially optimal ways. But then we should keep in mind that when we're talking about behavioral modification from a policy perspective, we're automatically assuming a certain level of paternalism. And, you know, there is a lot of discussion as well about, you know, the optimal level of paternalism, right? Is it really the task of a government in the end to influence the behavior of its taxpayers, of its citizens? And if it is, to what extent, right? Is there a line out here? You know, there's actually quite a lot of philosophical discussion about all this as well. I guess in summary, what I'm saying is that there are applications of nudge theory, but, you know, public policy is a much vaster space than that.
The last question that we'll take is actually, these are questions related to Priya, so you can answer these. Do you think having a BA economics is any edge over a BSc in economics or vice versa? And what is the difference?
Okay, so here again, I think it kind of comes down to your own references and what you see for yourself, you know, moving forward. A BSc in economics would presumably focus more on the quant side. So you have more courses in math, you have more courses in stats, you might have more courses in, you know, programming, you might be able to take more courses in, you know, other science related subjects. The BA in economics might focus more on, you know, you'll have courses on the history of economic thought, you'll have courses on ideas in economics. You will still have courses obviously on the quant side, but the focus, but you might have fewer courses. You might focus more on, you know, ideas in economics, you might focus more on you know, other areas of econ that might not be covered in a BSc course. You know, if you're interested in trade theory, public choice, things like that might be covered, are more likely to be covered in a BA course than a BSc course. So it really does matter, I mean, a bit on your interests. And as to, you know, outcomes afterwards, here again, I mean, I think to the extent that a student is interested in the quant side of things, you know, they can look at more quant type jobs, but a BA will give you more of a rounding of the intellectual or the ideas of econ. And, you know, there'll be a lot of play in, you know, certain other fields.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Gaurav. And I think maybe we can invite Prithvi to answer this question again. Prithvi, do you have anything to add to this question of BA versus BSc economics? So to all of you, Prithvi is the divisional chair for Humanities and Social Sciences at TRIA. Prithvi, thank you. Would you like to take that question?
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to echo what Gaurav said. It's about the pedagogical emphasis on course mixes in each of the courses, BSc or BA. I think by and large, you're going to get a good grounding in both. And again, echoing, you know, what Gaurav said earlier, regardless of what you'd like to do, it is really good to have a good, you know, strong quantitative foundation, mathematical foundation to do any kind of economics, even if you're working on economic history. I'm a historian, but you know, I mean, you are in economic history also will work with large data sets. And so having good, sound sort of foundation in mathematics is good. So again, it depends on what you want to do with that education. But by and large, you know, good BA programs will also give you a very good foundation to do whatever it is that you want to study afterwards or whatever profession you want to enter. Using your knowledge of economics.
There's a question that you marked that you wanted to answer live. That is there a number of seats for a major at TRIA? If so, then how are the majors allocated?
So I responded in the chat box, but there are no limits in, there are no limit in the number of students who can opt for a particular major at TRIA. So we give that option to any student who joins TRIA to pursue any major that he or she wishes to study, as long as they're qualified to take those.
Yeah. Thank you so much to everyone who joined today. We'll have to end here. I mean, there are so many questions that are unanswered, but we hope we'll maybe do more sessions on economics. Thank you so much. And any parting thoughts, Gaurav or Prithvi, any parting thoughts for our audience?
Parting thoughts? Well, I will just say that I hope you found this session useful. I hope you found it informative. I hope it gave you a bit of a perspective on career opportunities. If you do decide to focus on economics or behavioral economics in general, I will say that I do believe that there are a lot of opportunities. I will also say that that might also partly be because I am biased. I am an economist, so yes, naturally, I do think that there are a lot of opportunities there. But even beyond that, I mean, I do think that, you know, there are a lot of things that can be done. And I do hope that you will consider, you know, coming and joining us at TRIA if you are interested in economics and you want to learn, because we can, you know, assure you that you'll be in good hands and you shall learn a lot. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Gaurav. And just to add, one final thought. I saw a lot of questions asking for recommendations of books, yes, courses to do. We can perhaps provide a short list of, 4 or 5, 6 books and some journal articles that people would find beneficial to read, particularly on behavioral economics. But having, met with a lot of students across the country for admissions, one observation, one recommendation that I have is please read as much as possible. There is a lot of literature available, lots of very readable books available on behavioral economics, or nonfiction books also, which will give you a good grounding in economics or in any on any subject for that matter. So please read a lot, and you also have lots of lectures. You don't need a structured course. You find a lot of TED Talks, a lot of lectures on YouTube, which you will find quite useful. So please, read, look for good lectures by eminent economists, eminent social scientists, whether it is in the TED Talk platform or on YouTube, preferably those who are affiliated with some of the great universities in the world. And that will help you to get a really good grounding in any of the social science disciplines. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to all. Thank you once again, Prithvi and Gaurav, for joining us. And to all of you who are in the grade 12 now, Kriya is opening the applications on the 19th of October. And we're starting early. The dates for the application will be on the website, and keep an eye on the website and the social media for more sessions on Kriya Engage. Thank you so much.